As the Church of Miracles, we have so much to be proud of, so much to be thankful for, and so much to look forward to. We are rich in culture, strong in family, faith, and service, and passionate in our dream to live the American dream. I'm proud to live in a country where that dream is not only possible, but is the expectation of every American. As a community, we've come a long way. We naturalized 1.5 million new citizens. We registered. We got out the vote. And I'm proud to say, 10 million Latino voters voted in 2008. That is a stunning, 32% increase over the last presidential contest. Latinos have reached an electoral map to the presidency. And we have a profound effect on state and local elections across the country. And this year, we'll have a greater impact by being fully counted in the census. Thank you. I'm happy to say that our vote gave us a seat at the table where American policy is made. We are making progress slowly but surely. Like on the trip program that provided hundreds of thousands of children with health insurance last year. And with a record number of Latino political appointees, many of them are here tonight. If you're a Latino political appointee in this administration, would you please stand? There are several of you. I only acknowledge a few. But let's thank them to their and please. Thank you. Thank you. In the confirmation of Sonia Sotomayor as our country's first Latina Supreme Court Justice. That being said, we still have much left to do. At a time when large numbers of Americans are struggling to keep their homes, we seem to be fighting by politics as usual. At a time when millions of Americans are out of work, it appears Washington is gridlocked. At a time when hundreds of thousands of troops are gathered to take their access to health care, Congress is stuck in the eager game of status quo. Robert Kennedy once quoted a patient claim first, but says in part, maybe we live in interesting times. Lately, I feel like humans prefer this specifically to us. Inaction is simply not acceptable. Not for our community, not for our country. No is not an option. Not when so many of our people survive at the margins of our economic system. If the economy is hurting, our communities are hurting even more. If health care is inaccessible, it advantages our people more. If the housing market is in crisis, you can bet our community is on the knife edge of foreclosure. In fact, the U.S. unemployment rate now stands at 10%. For Latinos, it is nearly 15%. For African Americans, it is 16%. One third of all Latinos have no health insurance, and in the last decade, nearly 1 million African Americans died from the lack of health care. Over the next 4 years, 1.3 million Latino families will lose their homes to foreclosure. We know a house is more than bricks and mortar. Our research shows that foreclosure takes a toll on our families in many ways. Think back to the first house you lived in and what it meant to your childhood. How important was that structure to you, however small it was? A home of security, stability, it is shelter, it is the foundation for our families. Families break apart from the fallout of foreclosure, and their families are destabilized, whole neighborhoods and communities are put in peril. The failure to act means real people get hurt. That is the cost of inaction, and that is what we pay for the price of gridlock and obstruction. What we pay for the politics of no. And yes, that goes for immigration too. I'm often asked, how can we keep pressing for comprehensive immigration reform in such a divisive political climate? How can we push in so many things on our country's agenda by that time down? And my answer is, how can we not? How can we ignore the cry of families whose lives are in limbo? And how can we turn our backs on thousands of promising young students who just want a chance to go to college? Just because it's tough? Just because it's hard? I don't think so. Congress's inaction on immigration resulted in people getting up on the fringe of American political debate. Victims of those who tried to white supremacy appearing suddenly on cable television news and within the political mainstream. Fueled by the extreme and hateful rhetoric that has infected the immigration debate, harsh, local, anti-immigrant measures were pushed by politicians and media, all too willing to whip up public anger and to jack up their poll numbers or to pump up their ratings. In fact, just a couple of weeks ago, the first conference of the Tea Party movement chose former Congressman Tom Cantrell to be its opening speaker. Cantrell not only openly mocked Latino and African American voters, he advocated restoring the historic barriers that kept out our African American brothers and sisters from the ballot. He called for the reinstitution of literacy tests for voters. He forbid everyone pause to see growing movements in this country embrace the politics of hate. Because when political leaders and the news media humanize immigrants as a built our way of life, when they tell us falsely that immigrants bring disease and trauma to our community, when they tell us the fiction that immigrants are subversive and a threat to the sovereignty of the United States, it should be no surprise that people take matters into their own hands. Over the past 5 years, hate crimes against Latinos have spiked. The failure to act has created a climate of fear where anyone who is Hispanic is threatened whether they are citizens of this country or not. Last year, my son said, a resident of Castro, New York, was shot to death by a group of young teenagers having extra strokes. Suffolk County Police said that the defendant told them they just wanted to beat someone up to make this case. The same case is not unique. Hate crimes like this are playing out in communities across America. That's the horrific death of these communities in San Diego, Pennsylvania. These incidents should serve as a wake-up call for America. And some of it is very close to home. A New Jersey man, known online as Jennifer579, was recently indicted for threatening the lives of two leaders of Latino civil rights organizations, including MUNA, MALDEC, and NCLR. I want to thank Assistant Attorney General Tom Perez for pursuing this case and for reopening the case in Shenandoah. Every day, we fail to act on immigration, our people and our organizations get hurt. That is why we will continue to fight for immigration reform. It is a moral imperative. It is the right thing to do. That's why we're going to fight for immigration reform. The irony is that most Americans are on our side. Americans want access to health care. They want jobs. They want to fix our broken immigration system. Step outside of Washington and you will find that most people want less politics and more solutions. They voted for change. They deserve more from Washington. As a nation, we cannot sit idly by and watch as communities founder beneath the political clouds. We cannot shrug our shoulders and say, well, that's just the way Washington works. We need to bring the message home that the politics of no is no longer acceptable. America deserves better than this. core values as Americans compel us to make sure that families are not torn apart, that workers are not harassed or exploited for simply wanting to work, and that people are not hurt or killed just because of where they come from or what they look like. Those values unite us as Americans and keep us working towards solutions. And when we unite, we make a difference. Over the last several years, new doubt was not to assault on Hispanics and immigration to both outlays from across America. We turned our outlays into action. Thousands of science officials, viewers expressed frustration during a series of CNN promotional events, and NCLR and others looked at advertisers and asked them to disassociate their brands from the show that regularly disparaged their best customers. Dozens of corporations finally withdrew their ads. And on November 11, 2009, Murguía broadcast his last show on CNN. Murguía no longer has a platform on CNN to talk about this because we came together, because we were united, and because we used our political and economic clout to make our case. So let's stay together. Let's stay united to combat the politics of no. We will march again. We will engage. We will represent. We will advocate. We will register. We will be counted. We will vote. And we will not give up. Muchísimas gracias y adelante con nuestra comunidad. Thank you all very much.